أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصمه ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته everybody I'm actually traveling pretty soon so I won't be able to do the following sessions of this series live so I'm getting them recorded now so you can benefit from them continuously even as I'm not able to broadcast live One thing outstanding from a previous session about the word furqan that I wanted to add to what I discussed and clarify some things about that. One of those things is actually the grammar of it. For those of you that are following along with the Arabic, bayinatin is the hal. And then that hal is furthered by two things, min al-huda wal-furqan. So the min al-furqani, yani min al-huda wa min al-furqani. What that means simply, practically, for you know people to get lessons from it, is that on the one hand, Qur'an is guidance, Qur'an is counsel for somebody who wants advice and needs some help with Allah from Allah's own words in a situation they're going through. It's guidance for everybody, huda linnas, Muslim or non. Anybody opens this book and wants guidance, they'll get it. I'm actually reminded of somebody who I met recently, non-Muslim, who came to me at one of my programs, introduced himself and told me that he's been following my discussions on the Qur'an and they've helped him a lot in his life and he's not a Muslim. Right, and I've met several people like that. Even the Quran will guide people and give counsel to people, even if they haven't accepted entirely the faith yet. So there's that universal, okay, I want this advice, I'm ready to take it. But there's another group of people that says, no, I have a deeper problem. I need further clarity. I the general advice or this general counsel is good, but I have a much more complex issue and I need much more clarity. And for them, there's bayinati min al-huda. And then finally, there's al-furqan. You know, there's clarification from within that guidance, deep clarification, which means, yes, Qur'an is supposed to be, you know, easy to understand, but for seeking that clarification, effort is needed. But the other part, al-furqan, that what I wanted to highlight is, some people commented in the video also, that Allah says that He gave Musa the book and the furqan. وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَالْفُرْقَانَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ We gave Musa the book and the furqan. And I said Allah gave the Qur'an as the furqan. And Allah says also in the Qur'an that He gave Musa al-furqan also. So how do we reconcile that? Because I said the Qur'an's the unique al-furqan. The thing that it needs to be understood, first and foremost, is Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا You know, in another place, He says He gave Musa and Harun the furqan. Musa and Harun the Furqan. If the word Furqan meant the book, revelation, well, the book was only given to Musa. And the ayah says He gave it to both of them. Now, what did He give to both of them? What He gave to both of them, for example, He says, فَذْهَبَ بِآيَاتِنَا Both of you go with our miracles. The staff, the water parting, He was supposed to be right by Him, and Musa alayhi salam was supposed to have the support of Harun alayhi salam. They were both joined in presenting the miracles of Allah in front of the people. In other words, what separated in the eyes of the Egyptian empire, the claim of Musa from the claim of magicians was these miraculous events. And that was his Furqan in addition to the book. The book was a separate thing and the Furqan was a separate thing. And that's pretty clear in how, and it, by the way, the same origin, Furqan, gives you the word farq. And that's the verb that's used when Musa ultimately separated his people from the Egyptians and he parted the water. وَفَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرِ When we parted the water from the same origin, فَرَقْنَا, the water for you. So that's a little bit of a clarification about how the Furqan for previous revelation was something else. But in the Qur'an, the message and the miracle that separates it from the word of human beings, all of that, the evidence for its divine origin is within one book. It's one thing. So Qur'an is at the same time huda, and it's at the same time bayinatin min al-furqan in this case. So now moving on to something very, very heavy and very beautiful. Allah now, after describing that we have to fast for 30 days or for the entirety of the month, and if you miss a fast, then you got to make it up. Then He says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ Allah wants ease for you. And what I find remarkable about this portion of the ayah is that this is the first time Allah is being mentioned in the ayah. He said, the month of Ramadan is the one in which the Qur'an was revealed. as if he's not going to tell you that I revealed it, Allah revealed it. It was revealed. It serves the role of guidance. It serves the role of clarification. Whoever is going to fast, or whoever gets to witness this month should fast. Whoever misses it should make up. Notice there's no mention of Allah yet. And then he says, Allah wants ease for you. As if this exercise, never forget, behind this exercise and this injunction and this revelation, behind all of it is someone who really loves you and actually did all of this to make things easier for you. 30 days of fasting as opposed to lesser days for previous people, and yet Allah says, Allah wants ease for you. This is a very profound statement, because to achieve a goal, if somebody said, I want to get a PhD, right? And somebody said, okay, I got a program. If you join this program, you can get a PhD in 2 weeks. Somebody else spends 8 years trying to get it, 5 years trying to get it, 4 years trying to get it, 10 years trying to get it, and you're going to get it in 2 weeks? How did you get a shortcut to get a PhD? Impossible. The same way, the consciousness of Allah, a spiritual like recognition of Allah, is a very easy, very difficult thing to get. Like, talking about taqwa and God consciousness is easy, but feeling the presence of Allah in your heart and really being spiritually enlightened is, people spend years in monasteries. Other religions develop entire, seminaries where they're hoping to develop this spiritual presence for themselves. All kinds of exercises, meditation exercises, and all kinds of, rituals are developed so people can gain spiritual consciousness, awareness, enlightenment, if you will. And Allah says, I've just given you these 30 days, and I've made it miraculously easy in these 30 days. Just connect with this book. Allah wants ease for you. He's going to give you a spiritual enlightenment in a way that's easier for anybody else. And has never even made this so easy for people before you. This is for you especially. Allah wants this ease for you. So that's one of the implications of Allah wanting ease for you. The other is, of course, it's Ramadan. It's the hottest time of the year for the desert Arabs. And they're being introduced to 30 straight days of fasting. Allah says, I intend ease for you. Also means that I'm going to make miraculously this month's fasting easier than any other time. Test it yourself. You try to fast in Ramadan, it's tough. But try to fast any other time outside of Ramadan. It's like exponentially harder. Allah makes things easy in this month, the things that bring you closer to Him, than any other time. He removes obstacles from within your body, from within your mind, from within your heart, that make things harder. And so Allah wants ease for you. Then the next part of this, well, why are you getting closer to Allah? Why are you and I going to engage in worship? Why are you and I going to think about what Allah is telling us and try to make these changes in our life? You see, you and I always want things in life. Allah made human beings with desires, temptations, greed, want. We're thinking about what we want or what we couldn't get all the time. We're thinking about our loss all the time. We're thinking about our aspirations of what we want to accomplish, or what we want to have in our possession, or what we want to feel all the time. And Allah says He wants ease for us, because when human beings run after what we want, often we end ourselves in more trouble than when we started. Like, we make things harder for ourselves, thinking it's going to make us happy. The choices we make things more miserable, more difficult. Life becomes more burdensome. I'll give you a simple example. Somebody says, I really just want to get a house. I wish I had a house. If I just had a house, I'd be happy. And then they decide to take a huge loan and get this beautiful house. And they're really happy for a few weeks, a few months. They're really happy with their house. But then the debt starts piling up, the bills start piling up, the property tax start piling up, the pipes go bad, the plumbing goes bad, the electricity issues happen, this happens, that happens, the wear and tear in the house. And man, what used to be it's going to make things easy has made things so much harder. You ran after this like this is going to make you happy, and this is going to be the end of all your problems, and this is your goal in life. But once you have it, and you have it in your possession, things became so, so much harder. So Allah says, if you can take this guidance, and if you can really condition your heart to really truly accepting this guidance, then as you follow it, your life is actually going to become easier. You think fasting itself is hard. The fruits of fasting make your life easier. So He says, for example, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ. Allah wants to lighten your burden. These laws, you know, people who don't understand that, they say, wow, fasting, Islam is so hard, man. You got to fast all of Ramadan. It's going to be so tough. How do you even do it? You don't realize when you have this tough exercise, but what you get out of this tough exercise is so much more, then this becomes easy. And so I leave you with this last example to think about that. Incentive. Just the example of incentive. If I asked somebody to work all day in the hot sun and said to them, when you finish working all day in the hot sun, I'm going to give you a nice cooked meal. That's your reward. They'll say, no thanks. I'd rather eat a pizza. I'm good. I'm not working out there for just a nice cooked meal. Another person I call and I say, why don't you work out there in the hot sun all day? And at the end of that, I will give you my house. I'll sign it over to you. I'll sign over my house to you. All of a sudden, that day is not so hot anymore. That labor is not so difficult anymore. Why? Because what you're getting out of it is so much more worth that effort that you actually don't even feel as tired because you know what you're getting out of it. That's actually the point that's being made here when Allah says Allah wants ease for you. Allah wants ease as a result of this exercise for you in your life. Ramadan is supposed to make a transformation in you and me that will save us from a lot of trouble. You know, Allah made this in all things. This is a sunnah, way of Allah doing things in all things. For example, exercise. Somebody changes their diet, changes their exercise. It's hard. Exercise is hard work. Changing your diet is hard work. But if you do it, you're saving yourself from diabetes, heart problems, back problems, arthritis, all these difficulties that were going to come to you in 20, 30 years. You saved yourself from so much because you put yourself through this exercise, this rigorous discipline. That's exactly the point that Allah is making when He says profoundly, Allah wants ease for you. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.